My name is Jaswindar Missan, and date of birth is 30th January 1941. And I was born at Mombasa, Kenya.
I gather you played most of your early school and international career in Kenya. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, I started playing for my school in the beginning. Then I played for the Sikh Union Club at Mombasa at the age of 15, first 11 hockey. And then at the age of 17, I went to Nairobi, trained, and I was selected to play for Kenya against England.
What position did you play?
I played at right half position.
And were you very fit then?
Yes, very, very fit. One had to work very hard. And you deliberately did training at 29 degrees, 30 degrees temperatures.
Were you playing at altitude?
No, and at Nairobi, Nairobi is at an altitude of about 6,000 feet. So whenever I went from Mombasa to Nairobi, you had to sort of work harder, because at a higher altitude you become restless quickly, unless you've trained at altitude.
And how many games did you play at international level, or how long was your career?
No, because what happened in 19... I played in 1958, and then I played another one in Mombasa. It was against India. And after that, I was not selected for Rome. So I was very disappointed, but then I came to England in 61 to study. So I put all my effort to study and also to ensure I play hockey. When I first came to the trials at the university and looked at the ground, and the first thing, it enlightens you to see such a good pitch. it was sort of, you then play butter hockey, sort of thing.
So there was a significant difference between the standard of the pitches at London University than from Kenya.
Yeah, because in Kenya, in Nairobi, in Mombasa, we play on hard, it's very hard, as you know, in tropical countries. And the only very good pitch in Mombasa was at Mombasa Sports Club, which was an exclusive English club. we used to play against them, or if another side, say from Zambia, has come, we would play there, something. And that was really like a turf. It was specially imported from South Africa. I enjoyed hockey and I played, and naturally, when I first come to this country, they think I'm a different person, and my style of hockey was slightly different.
In what way?
It was in the style of dribbling, mostly, and also running at people. It's like a kind of sports, I think, when you run at people, it's far better. I mean, you can appreciate the hockey here, because like today, India were playing backwards, whereas the Australians were playing forward, where the ball should be. Yeah. So this is, I'm always impressed on people that you, that's what you are. You don't want to go backwards. Yeah. So those sort of things, I, you know. And then the other thing is that in our days, because we used to play on Wednesdays, we had all the top national papers. They used to send a reporter. They started sending one because something must have happened, because we all, after the trials, all the university sides started gelling. It never happened before. Yeah? And we started winning. So, as I said, the papers were there, you know, like Pat Rowley, you know. There's a Dickie Hollands who passed away, and Smith who used to do. Yeah. And the other one as well, there's another writer who used to write.
Bill Caldwell?
Bill Caldwell wasn't, he used to umpire at those time, at those days.
Holland?
Yeah, Dickie Hollands did, yeah. He used to. And there was another person, Pat Ward Thomas. He used to write for the Garden, Pat Rowley took over. Yeah. So after finishing, I played at the university for 4 years, and also got selected for British universities. They used to have tournaments, and if you remember, and so I was very lucky again. And we also had a very good stick player. Not a stick player; he was a very body player. And I really enjoyed playing with him, because he could play hockey. Because he is a Balkakaria. Yeah. He's not. I mean, and so, I mean, that brought us together, and it also brought the university name up, you see. And also, I was also selected for Surrey in 1962. Yeah. So I played for Surrey for about eight years.
And did you get selected for anything beyond Surrey?
No, because I'd already played for Kenya. They were not, you see, so...
You weren't allowed to change allegiance?
Yeah, no, because it was a rule that, yeah. I think it was a... And because in 1960, I was very, very disappointed, I was, for not being picked for the wrong team, you know. Naturally, you would be. Yeah. And then the president of the hockey association came here in 1963, and he said, "Would you like to come back?" And I thought hard and long, and I said. I said no. Yeah.
That must have been a difficult decision.
Very, very. Yeah, I would have loved to go back. You see, because I hadn't, since coming to England, I hadn't really trained. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because in order to be very fit, what you want to achieve is that when you come to fitness, you want to be a second more faster than the person who's going to tackle me and run back. Yeah. So, in that respect, I had no problems when I first started training, because fortunately the amenities for doing all that was across our house was the school ground. It had a cricket ground, football, cricket and all that, and they had also a sand patch, and also the stadium was just 300 yards away. So those sort of amenities were very useful.
Yes.
And what you find these days, it's very, very hard work. It's like my university, I mean, first days at the university, and I said, it gets dark at 3 o'clock. I'm not worried about the darkness. I said, where do I train? Yeah. I used to live near, the first year I lived near West Ham Stadium,
mm-hmm.
Club, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I never went to see, I only saw one match. But if I came to West, it cost a lot of money just to train.
Yeah.
Because you have to train. I mean, that I always say to anybody, I said, people say you must train with a team. I said, no, what you do is individually you train. You know, you can learn dribbling by yourself. You don't need somebody else. See? Because on those days we used to play on grass. The game was, well, I enjoyed it, you see. But now, I mean, you can see which is a fitter side.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, and how the way they move.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, in the respect of hockey, I also made a lot of friends.
Okay.
Very, very good friends.
Yeah. When you left university, you went to Spencer.
So, yeah, I joined Spencer.
Did you find more time for training then, or because of work?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Was it difficult?
Very difficult, because I, just before the season start, they used to run around and do training, you see, and I tried to run around. I used to live in Camberley in those days, you see, Camberley to Spencer is a long way, but as I said in my earlier on, that I want to play for one club. I played for one club back home. A lot of people would say, can you come and play for us when I retired? I said, no. You know, it's nice, you know, but you have to think. And then you have a family. You know, you have to look at the family.
How long did you play for Spencer?
I played from 1965 to 1977.
That's a long career.
It is. But my fitness was going downhill, you see, because I wasn't training. So, you know, in order to really play, you know, and then we started playing on Astro. Yeah, it was a different game altogether. You've learnt your stick work on the grass, you know, and the stick work on the grass doesn't really entails you to play on the Astro. So you have to work, so you have to sort of start training on the Astro.
It's different.
Different, you see. And then I think the International Hockey Board also decided that slowly, because there were no goals. I mean, at that time, they want to ensure that the hockey gets more popular by modifying rules.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, over the years. So they've taken step by step. Yeah, but then sometimes you wonder, some of the rules may be overboard.
So which of the modern rules would you not like?
I think the biggest one, the ball in the D. Yeah, and you see some of the matches, you know, and because sometimes I watch until lifted ball. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
The lifted ball. There's never been a rule on lifted ball into the D. Never. It's called a dangerous ball. Yeah, yeah. And then now you find some of these times they lift the ball and they hit you on the shin. They still play on, you know, give a short corner, which is, you know, those sort of things. And the way the sticks are hitting each other, I mean, you can see the rattle today. those sort of things. The other rules, yes. But the obstruction rule, and I think it was, the obstruction rule always been there in our days, yeah. It's like, if I used to have a lot of discussions, you know, like, I used to have a discussion like Bill Cole, you see, Goldville and others, and I used to say to them, just please tell me, if you're facing your own goal and you stop the ball, show me in the book, in the rule book, that you're obstructing. Yeah? It's not obstruction. You move away from him. It's the same rule now, isn't it? You move away. But it's just the turning. Sometimes you find the turnings, as, you know. Yeah, yeah. So this is, so people used to say, like Peter, he was another international umpire, Peter, oh, I can't hear that, so he was Anglo-Indian. And I said that is obstruction. He says, no, you don't understand obstruction. That's the way I used to tell them. I said, show me.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, you went on and got involved in administration and organization of hockey at Spencer?
At Spencer, and also we, after the university days, we all, because the colors for university are purples, so we formed a purples club. Yeah. And in there, we started getting together, and the person who was behind was Bob Watson, and he then got us all together, and we started planning, and we started trying to get fixtures and everything, and then from there became the treasurers, and everybody had to do their work, you see.
But you became president of,
yeah,
Spencer?
Yep. In, I don't even remember which year, 70, I played hockey, then I became the captain in 72, 73. I think, yeah, it was 72, 73 when we won the league and the Surrey Cup. And our second 11 also won the cup at the same time, the league as well. So it's just like, you know, that's right, you see. And from being a captain, say, then you become a vice president, it isn't so much. But then I think it's like everybody have to take that turn, and I became a president for 3 years. Yeah, I'm glad it was, because we only limit for 3 years. Yeah. So you had to sort of attend meetings, you know.
Do you remember any main achievements during that time as president? Any changes?
The club expanded sort of exponentially, you know, because the moment we brought in the ladies' side, yeah. Because as you very well know, that hockey used to start at 2 o'clock and 4:30. It was only the men drinking, you see. And fortunately, in those days, the problem of alcohol didn't. So now, from there onwards, what we did is to form the ladies' side, and we got ladies involved as well. So, and now I think they have so many members, you know, and it's a big club, you see. And we also had we had to raise quite a lot of money to fund the AstroTurf. Otherwise, you're losing so much money from the bar as well, you know. So those are, I call, little achievements for myself, you know. Yeah.
And your involvement with Asian hockey?
No, the Asian hockey was, I became a member of the London Indians Hockey Club, yeah. And I started playing for them, and then we used to go to tournaments and things like that. And then I became the treasurer of the London Indians Hockey Club. So from there we used to then organize, you know, the matches, the fixtures. And Jimmy James, who's passed away, he was the president for quite a long time, which was good for us, really. And then at least we could achieve sort of a higher level, because we used to play international sides. So it is very, so it was very, very, again, enjoyable, you know, where you bring in the Indian hockey into this country.
And you retired from hockey in 1977, is that right?
Yeah, I just completely retired.
So you didn't play any masters?
No, I played veterans, yeah. In 84, I suffered a heart attack. Yeah, and I had two bypasses. And so I started playing veterans hockey.
You started
playing
after your bypass operation?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And this was good for your heart? Well, you're still here, obviously.
Most of the veterans tournament was either the local one and the, you know, like Lamas, you remember Lamas?
Yeah.
And then we used to have, we used to go to Lamas at, near Brussels, Oranje place. I don't know whether you've heard of that tournament. I used to go with them just to enjoy, you know, for 2-3 days. You know. But then for that, I used to practice a bit to get my heart beat. And I used to play. I played for about 7-8 years.
And what's your involvement with hockey now? Do you just...
No, I have very minimum, really. I don't have, I mean, as such, except that now I know how to get here.
Yes.
Yeah. And so I will come and watch more games.
Yeah, and you said you've made lots of friends through hockey.
Yeah.
And have these been lifelong friends that you still see?
Yeah, I've met them. I mean, all from the university days. Some have died, but some are still alive. And And I mean, today I met people who I haven't seen them for a long time, you know. So it's nice to see the faces, you see.
That's good.
Yeah. And it was very nice to see Pat really getting his, I think, was it OBE or CBE? BEM. Yeah, so, yeah. I'm so glad because I've known him since 62.
Yeah. He's done a lot.
Oh, yeah, he has. And he used to discuss with me, you know.
Well, Jazz, it's been a delight talking to you. Thank you very much indeed for sharing all your memories with me.
Okay, thank you.